those of you who don't know me, I am Dr. Birch. This is Humanity 325, the philosophy of language.
The occurrence at the beginning of this story, a young girl goes missing from the university that Evan Birch, my character, works at. Some focus is placed on him, and he, you know, he's under the spotlight, as it were.
I play Detective Robert Malloy. He's a man who's been on the force for many, many years. You have a man that was there at the scene of the crime of this missing girl. All the emblems point to him. So I come to his door asking for and looking for answers to certain questions.
It's a little cat and mouse kind of game between Malloy and Evan. You know, obviously as a cop, as a detective, he has to approach things in a very delicate way, particularly when he's dealing with a character like mine who is very good with words, is very clever.
Yes.
So there's no such thing as truth.
Well, let me ask you this. Can I tell you the truth? Or can I tell you what I perceive or interpret as the truth, as best my memory will allow? And of course, then Malloy has to work out a cleverer way to actually get to this character of mine.
He's a suspect. When the curtain goes up, he's a suspect, and he remains a suspect throughout the making of the movie and throughout the story within the proscenium arch of the film.
He has a little past. You know, there's been an incident that's occurred some years before at another university that meant that he and his family needed to leave and move on from that town and come to this town. He has a wife, played by Minnie Driver, and we have two beautiful young kids. But you get the sense through the beginning of the story that because of this past event, you know, there are perhaps things that are unresolved.
She gets pushed to a place I don't think she's ever been before, and you watch her unravel, which is very interesting to me. They have a marriage that is fragile, but only once you shine a light on it.
Ellen's immediately suspicious of Evan. She does her utmost to try and keep things stable, but you do see her find the strength to stand up to him, thankfully, eventually.
It's a really interesting idea to begin with the very apparent guilt of a protagonist and then to watch that unfold really unexpectedly.
The cast is like, forget it, it's off the charts.
Actors like Minnie Driver and Pearce Brosnan and Guy Pearce are so professional, they're so experienced. In many ways, I feel like I'm cheating because it's like they're doing half my job.
You know, we knew this was a really good job, like really smart, good film. It's nice to be with like-minded people doing that, you know, so there's definitely a sense of really happy to be here.
A lot of the tension and the emotional part of the book comes from the interaction of my main character, Professor, who's Guy Pearce, with the detective, Pierce Brosnan, and with his wife, Minnie Driver. So when you have three actors of that caliber working together and playing off each other, I think that's just wonderful.
One of the most rewarding parts of the process is to start talking about a character with an actor and start to calibrate how that character is going to be. Especially, I mean, good actors, they bring something to the table. That's why they're there. And I think it's important to make them feel part of it. I think Guy Pearce has the perfect pedigree for the character of Evan because he has done so many different kinds of movies. As an audience, we can never be certain what kind of character he does. He does so many different characters, often very complex characters.
The initial interrogation scene that I had with Pearce was really satisfying. You've just got the stage. It's just the two of you basically in a room together trying to outdo each other.
Guy is somebody who I really like and admire tremendously. He plays with such precision, articulation and intelligence of character. He has a presence on screen that has always been just crystal clear.
It was very appealing to have Pierce Brosnan playing sort of a less polished character in this, you know, opposed to Guy Pearce. The fact that he wanted to do this part told me that he wanted to do something a little bit different.
We're in the same racket.
What racket is that?
Proof. Searching for the truth. Truth hides.
It was great to work with Pearce because I'd not worked with him before, and You know, he's really delightful and wonderful. Strangely, we were filming at Pearce College as well. So we had Guy Pearce, Pearce Brosnan, and Pearce College. And in the script, it was Pearce College originally. So there were way too many Pierces going on. And Minnie, I mean, she's a pro. She's fantastic. She's really dynamic. She's not a pushover as an actress by any means, and she's not a pushover as a character in the film.
You have Minnie Driver. Minnie and I have known each other many, many years. We worked together on GoldenEye, which was my first James Bond movie. And it was a delight to be back in front of the camera with her again.
Well, thank you. You're spoiling me.
I've known Pierce since I was a little girl. He's just a good, wonderful soul and a really good actor. So it was nice to finally get to do that with him after all these years.
The main attraction in a project is always the script. It struck me as a sort of a modern film noir, which was very appealing to me because my first passion in film history basically was film noirs.
I was so taken by the script. I was really inspired and really, you know, immediately sort of there. I certainly didn't need to bring anything or add anything. It was really just about unpicking what was there and making sure I understood it.
Well, I thought it was a beautifully constructed script. I thought it had a very elliptical sensibility to it.
It's entirely character-driven. Without the characters' traits and flaws, there would be no story.
The idea came to me from a real-life event. A young girl disappeared from a lake, and the news reports talked about a white car that was seen in the parking lot. And I began to wonder about who was in the car, why that person didn't come forward. From that point on, I did not listen to the reports because I didn't want my imagination to be affected by the real story.
I read the book and was sort of taken by the story and more importantly by the main character. He's sort of inadvertently self-destructive. You know, when you write a thriller or any kind of mystery, there's a certain amount of math and architecture that's involved. How much do you tell the audience when? When do you let them in? When does the character find out everything? And does that happen before or after the audience finds out?